Thank you, Sister Nancy Irby. Thank you for blessing us with that great message and song. I must tell Jesus all of our problems. There's no there's no better problem solver than that of Jesus Christ. He is the answer to every question. He's a solution to every problem. If there's anything that we need to know or any help that we need to call on Jesus Christ, He and He alone. Thank you, Sister Nancy Irby, for blessing us. Let's pray together. Thank you, O God, for this moment that we have once again to worship together through technology with our church family across from San Bernardino to Beaumont to Victorville to Palm Springs to Orange County. To even outside of California. And now we ask you, Lord, for a deep understanding and clarity, Father, for where we are in today's time, Lord. If we ever needed the Lord before, we sure do need you now. If we ever needed the word, the clarity and understanding, we sure do need it now. So bless us now and give us what we need. Speak to our hearts, Lord, wherever we need to be spoken to. Touch us where we need to be touched, oh God. Impact us where we need to be impacted, oh God. Move us, oh God, where we need to be moved, oh God. So that, Lord, this word will not fall on deaf ears, that it won't be irrelevant, but it'll be relevant, and it'll be practical, and it'll be sustainable, Father. And it'll be a place of conversion, a new calling, a deeper sense to want to do more for you. So bless us now, we pray. Forgive us for our sins, oh God. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Block the enemy, Lord, as we open up this word. In Jesus' name I do pray. Amen. So I want to continue on with our freedom series. With this message, it's coming from a scripture that you may not find that talks much about this, but I figured out a few things, and so I do believe. And so let's go to the book of 1 Peter chapter 2, book of 1 Peter chapter 2, and we're gonna actually begin in verse number 11, 1 Peter chapter 2. Verse number 11, it's a true statement what was stated early in Sabbath school, that we need the Holy Spirit to give us, to speak to our hearts, to talk to us, to touch us, to give us clarity and understanding of the scriptures. We need that, and we get that only from the Holy Spirit. And so the Holy Spirit is pivotal in our walk with Christ. It is the Holy Spirit that leads us into understanding and righteousness, leads us into a movement in which when we hear the word of God, it moves us into not just being hearers, but also doers of the word of God. And the Holy Spirit is important. And that's why we pray for that Holy Spirit. I stated it earlier, and as the song says, if we ever needed the Lord before, we sure do need him now. Now, from all the things that are going on, from this, from the COVID-19, and cases are being spiked up or going higher. We can't go to Europe now. They banned us from going to Europe. There's a lot of other places that it's not a ban per se, but you know what? Some places that we just can't travel to for because airports are being closed and different things are happening to what we are seeing in the within the civic level of life, the racism coming back up to a higher level that we haven't seen in years, but it has always been there, but now being more talked about and touched on. Now we have the now we're facing a re-election that's soon to come in the next few months. Now with the Sahara winds or clouds or whatever, I got the word and I did a little research on it, but I didn't get all the details to it. And so when I heard it brought up again, from Amity talking about what's happening in Jamaica, it is true that it's going to be coming here to the United States from all of my understanding. And so it's just another one thing after another. The Bible makes it clear that, you know, it's going to be a time of sorrow. Time, you know, where things are going to be moving at a rapid pace. I'm not here to sound the alarm, but I am here to let everybody know that we need to continue to watch and pray. Let's watch and pray. We've been in this freedom series. This is our second part. We have another message next Sabbath, which is actually 4th of July, which we claim, say that we celebrate 4th of July for our independence as a nation. And I want to preach that sermon in light of what's been going on. I don't want you to miss next week either, or miss next week's message. It's a message entitled "Give Me Liberty or Give Me Death." Give Me Liberty or Give Me Death. That's going to be next week, and that will end our time together, referencing to the Zoom most likely. Then the next week after that, we have camp meeting, July the that will start that Tuesday, July the 7th. We have some great speakers, people from our conference, and then we will have a lady pastor from the East Coast is going to be delivering the message on that. On that weekend, that Friday and Sabbath, which will be the 10th and the 11th. But you can log on to our Zoom. We're going to work it out where you can log on to our Zoom. And then from there, you can we'll be able to broadcast. Hopefully, we're working it out where we can broadcast the camp meeting so you won't be confused. You can just log straight into us and we'll be able to do it from there. But we'll give you those details next week. Next week is a very pivotal week because next week we'll give you the instructions for the rest of the month of July, because I really do believe that we'll be opening up church right after camp meeting. That's the plan, that's the goal, that's the prayer. But we'll know for sure by next week. And so here we are. In this freedom series, looking at the book of First Peter chapter 2, verse 11, a message entitled, "So How Do We Fight?" So how do we fight? Verse 11 says, Beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation." I'm going to reread that. One second here. I want to make sure that, okay, yes. I'm going to reread that. Verse number 11 of 1 Peter chapter 2, "Beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation." Verse 13, "Therefore, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether to the king as supreme or to the governor as to those who are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. As free, yet not using liberty as a cloak for vice, but as bondservants of God, honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the King." May the Lord add a rich blessing to the reading and the hearing of his holy word. So how do we fight? I think I figured it out. We as a church have often been silent in situations that are, if you will, that are civic in nature, freedom in nature, legislatures, racial injustices. We have often been silent for years. It has been talked about that we as a church, referencing to the denomination of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and we preached a sermon already a couple weeks ago about it's in the name. So we already got that situated and we have the understanding. However, I think I figured it out. As I was reading through the commentary on this particular scripture, I began to understand why it appears that we ought to be quiet in civic matters, why we ought not to say a word. But I must disagree with some of the wording that was used in our commentary regarding this passage of scripture. I don't believe, and maybe I misunderstood it, maybe I took it the wrong way, but from what I read and from what I have seen and experienced within our church globally, we stay quiet with certain issues. But I want to share with you today that this is not of God. This is not a political fight, but it is a biblical fight. This is something that we ought to be doing because of what God has done for us. And when we see what Jesus has done. When we read the Gospels and we see even in the Old Testament how he has talked to us about ensuring that certain people, that all humanity is taken care of, but especially those that are weak, then it gives us once again the understanding and the motivation and the command to go out and do exactly what God did, what his son Jesus did, what we see in the New Testament, what the prophets did, referencing to the apostles, what they did. But when you read this, it begins in a way, or verse 13 kind of makes a change, but I want to share with you that the key component to this whole pericope from verse 11 to the end has to do with verse 11 and 12. It begins by saying, "Beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims." All right. Already, Peter is letting the people of God know that this is not our home. If you are a pilgrim, if you are a sojourner, that leads us to the understanding that wherever you are, that is not your home. And you know what? As Seventh-day Adventist Christians and as Christians, as people of God, humanity, the way the world is right now, this is not our home. And we have to stop saying, and I almost made the mistake of saying, as Seventh-day Adventists only, this is not our home. As Christians only, this is not our home. No, this is not this place as it is now. This is not the place that the Lord created for humanity. The Lord created the world in 6 literal days. And on the 7th day, he rested. In those 6 literal days, he allows us a picture to see of the perfection that he had. The evening and the morning were the first day. And the Lord created, and he ends the first day, and it was good. And the second day, and it was good. And the third day, it was good. And on, every day was good. We know that everything was perfect until Adam and Eve, until they sinned. And so the way when the Lord created the earth was perfect. We as humans were to live on a perfect planet. However, that's not how it panned out. The evilness, the craftiness of the enemy came in and then usurped the power of the enemy just for the simple fact that usurped the power of humanity. The enemy usurped the power of humanity just because they decided to eat some fruit. The appetite. We talked about temptation earlier. We talked about, do we know what our temptation is? To referencing to Matthew chapter 4, I heard the conversation during the time of Sabbath school, asking if we know what our proclivities are or where we are weak, will it help us? And I think it should, and it should help us, but it still does not mean that we can't fall for the weakness of Adam and Eve were that was that tree, if you will. They were not to partake of that fruit of that tree and to stay far away, but yet still they got close. And as a result, we are in the situation we are now. But this place is not my home. This place is not where I reside for eternity. I'm waiting for Jesus to come again, where we will have a new heaven and a new earth, a new place where God the Father is going to, and God the Son, where we're going to be with and communion with him forever and ever and ever. That's the time I'm looking for. And so we don't get caught up with the things of this earth. Lay not your treasures on earth where moth or rust destroy, but lay your treasures up in heaven where moth or rust will not destroy. Understand, because where your heart is, there your treasures will be. And so where is your treasure? We talked about this. Where is your heart? Are you connected so much to your house that you're willing to disobey God to keep your house? Are you so much connected to your car that you're willing to disobey God to keep your car? Are you so much connected to the things of this earth that you're willing to connect so much with the things of this earth to disobey God? I want to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that this place is not our home. We are waiting for the new heaven, a new heaven and a new earth where the Lord will create when he comes back. Let the church say amen. And so Peter begins the dialogue before he gets into submission to government, before he gets to submission of how slaves ought to treat or how to be in communication and relationship with their owners, before he gets into all that, this part of the pericope, and even before that, he says that we are chosen generation, a holy nation, in verse 9 of this passage. But here we are sojourners and pilgrims. And so watch now watch it. Watch the picture now. He says, beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. So abstain from those things that war against the soul, those proclivities, those propensities, those issues of sin that we carry or that we have because we are born in sin and shaped in iniquity. Abstain from those things. Stay far away from those trees that will make you fall. Stay far away from those things. Allow yourself to stay off of the devil's playground and get on God's side. Stay away from the enemy and stay close to Jesus. And he says, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts, which war against the soul. Uh-huh. Having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers. So let me pause right there. As they speak against you as evildoers, with this understanding, not that you are evil or that the Israelites were evil or the Jewish or the Hebrew people were evil, but when the Gentiles, when they begin to speak about them to others, Peter wanted them to be certain that whatever they have to say evil against you will be false. So don't give them any room to speak anything evil against you. That's what Peter is saying. So he says, they may, by your good works, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. So if you avoid those sinful habits, when the Gentiles have something to say about you, when they want to say something evil, for some reason, something good comes out their mouth. Balaam came down to curse the people of God. Every time he spoke something evil, nothing but praises came out of his mouth. We know the story back in the Old Testament. Balaam was coming to speak evil. But when he spoke evil, when he spoke curses, praises came out of his mouth. Don't allow anyone to say anything evil against you. As soon as they want to say something evil against you, they can't find any room. Why is this important? What is the setup? How does this equate to this message? So how do you fight? Well, here it is. I'm glad you asked the question. I'm glad you're intrigued. I'm glad you're taking notes. I'm glad you're being into it, trying to figure out, okay, where is Thompson going? Well, watch this. The way we look at this passage of scripture is we have to put it in today's context. In that day, we recognize that those that were considered the symbolism here. The nation of there were two types of people in the world, if you will. They were the Gentiles and it were the Hebrews. The Hebrews were considered the people of God, God's people. The Gentiles were the people of the world. So when Paul talks about in Romans and primarily Romans, but throughout all of his epistles, he talks about this thing of grafting in, about them coming into the Gentiles, being converted and being grafted into what we call spiritual Israel. So the understanding behind it is that the Israel were God's people. Gentiles were the people of the world. And so Peter did not want the people of the world to have anything evil to say against God's people. And so it is today. We as Christians don't want the people of the world to say anything negative against the Christians. So please do not give them room to say anything negative about the Christians. So how does that apply? Well, at school, it applies to you at school that you ensure that you don't cheat on your tests. You ensure that you have great work ethic. You ensure that you are doing your work and you're being cooperative in class and you're paying attention in class. How does it apply to you on your job? Well, you don't talk negative about your boss like everyone else is talking. You don't say certain things. You don't on breaks, you don't go to certain places, or you don't break a certain way to how other people will break on their job. Maybe they want to smoke a cigarette. Maybe they want to do this. Maybe they want to do that. Maybe they want to skip out on work. You don't do those things. You keep everything up. You keep everything, you be a man or a woman of integrity. Keep everything on the up and up. How does it apply to you? In every day of life, when you're at the grocery store, you want to ensure that people know that you are a Christian just by the way, not only by the way you walk, not only by the way you talk, but also not only by the way you dress, but more importantly, by the way you act. Because sometimes we get caught up by these people that could speak so well that they must be great Christians. We get caught up by the way people dress because they dress in a suit. They must be better than somebody else. We get so caught up by the way somebody walks because it appears by the way they walk. Maybe they're not walking with the Lord. But I want to tell you, it's not about the walk. It's not about the talk. It's not about the dress. It's about the action. And indeed, love people not only in word, but also in deed. 1 John 3, verse 18. And so have the understanding that we don't want the world to have anything to say negative about the Christian church. But when that time comes, that they will only say positive things about the Christian church, because we, as a Christian church, the Seventh-day Adventist Christian church, we represent Jesus. Amen, somebody. Okay, all right, so here we are. Watch this. So now, it says, therefore, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether to the king as supreme. So you submit yourself to the government. What the government says for us to do, we ought to do. The Lord said it when he was here. Jesus said, render unto Caesar what is Caesar's and unto God what is God. Verse 14, or to governors, as to those who are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good, you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. So by doing the right thing, you will put people to silence as free, as a freedom that we carry, yet not using liberty as a cloak for vice, but as bondservants of God. So even though you are free, referencing to the freedom that we carry within the nation, that does not mean we utilize our freedom to go against God's word or against God's will. We got to use our freedom for faith, or we use our freedom for good. We utilize our freedom to lift up the name of Jesus. And then it says, honor all people, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. So it paints this picture that we must go along with everything the government says, as long as it is not against the will of God. Well, we as a church, now I'm talking about the Seventh-day Adventist church, we have often noted the only thing that goes against the will of God that we need to stand up for is when it comes to the Sabbath. We are waiting for that day. We've been waiting. And the time is closer than ever before. But we have missed opportunity to stand up with others despite of how we may think, despite of how we may feel, despite of what we may think. Now, there are certain things that we ought not to stand up with others on, but there are certain things that we could have and we should have stood up on. This is not the time to go through everything or to go through any of it at all. Maybe in a certain conversation, we can have a dialogue in which you say, well, Pastor, what are some of the things that we should have been standing up for from when we should not have? But here is one. What is going on in the world today, the social injustices that are going on in the world today, are things that we ought to stand up for because it goes against God's will. People are trying to make it political, but it is not political. It is biblical. We understand that the oppressed and the poor will always be with us. And so we as a people that have freedom must utilize our freedom not for bad things, not for vices, but we must utilize our freedom to lift up the kingdom of God. So we must let people know the power of Jesus Christ, the way Jesus carried himself here on earth, the things that he did, because as quiet as it is kept, and it's really not kept quiet, we know that Jesus went against the laws of the land, if you will. Now, he didn't go against them in terms of his own, for his own satisfaction. He went against the laws of the land when it went against his will, his character, the character of God. When someone needed to be healed on the Sabbath, he healed them on the Sabbath. He didn't care what the people said in those days, the referencing to the Sanhedrin and the Pharisees, I should say, the religious rulers. He didn't care what they said. When it came to the lady who was caught in adultery, they both tried to get him. The Hebrews tried to get him. The Romans tried to get him. But Jesus, in his wisdom, just began to write down on the sand the sins of them all. And so we have to note and understand that it is not only the Sabbath that will be something against God's will. There are other things that happen in society, in humanity, that we must stand up for. How do we fight? Well, we have to fight in peace. We have to fight in a way that is nonviolent. I believe in all those things. But now I want to get a little bit deeper. I want to get a little bit deeper of how do we fight? How do we fight? I think we have seen it enough. We have read Ellen White quotes enough. We have heard some of the sermons now that we are all on the same page for most of us with the understanding of how we should fight, at least at this church. But this is something that we need to reiterate. We need to continue to preach on. We need to continue to talk about, because we have to get this message out across the denomination, across this great church. If we believe in all what we believe in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, of its purpose, of why it was formed, of why it was organized, of why we are here, in the purpose of our church in today's history, well, then we must be all on one accord. The church will be stronger if we are all together on these issues. That's why tonight is so important at 7 o'clock for that prayer vigil. That's why it's so important as two different churches from different backgrounds, if you will, different ethnicities, if you will, are coming together, and we're going to unite on one accord. That's why it's so important. So how do you fight, Pastor Thompson? How do you fight? How do you want us to fight? What is the Bible telling us of how we should fight? Well, we ought to know already that we ought to fight in love. We ought to know already that we have to fight nonviolently. We have to take up the mantle of Jesus, as he was we talk about Martin Luther King Jr., praise God for him, for his work. We talk about Gandhi, praise God for his work, but everything starts with Jesus. Jesus, he took a nonviolent approach. When they beat him, when they scourged him, when they gave him a crown of thorns, when they talked about him, when they hung him on that cross, he did not lift a finger. And all Jesus had to do was just say one word and he would have wiped everybody away. But Jesus, in his love and in his mercy towards us, he stated to us that, you know, he showcased us that, you know what, he said words like, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. He says, he showed words to us where he was still saving people on the cross. And so we ought to take the same approach. Yes, we can look at Mahatma Gandhi. Yes, we can look at Martin Luther King Jr., but let's look at Jesus the Christ, the originator of this movement of a peaceful, nonviolent protest, the one Jesus the Christ who did it and started it off. And now we see Peter letting us know that we ought to submit to government. Yes, we ought to. We ought to submit to the government. We ought to render unto Caesar what is Caesar, unto God what is God's. But when it goes against the will of God, and it's just not the Sabbath, church, it is helping. And when laws are passed that takes advantage of poor people, that is wrong. When laws are passed where it will take advantage of breaking up the family structure, that is wrong. When laws are being passed where it is against where one race is being highlighted more than another, that is wrong. And you know what? I might get flack for this one, but I'm gonna say it anyways. I was watching the news yesterday. I think it was yesterday. Yesterday or 2 days ago, and I know there's two sides to this, and I know there's two sides to this, but it broke my heart. Maybe it's because it's a colleague of mine, and I don't call only other Seventh-day Adventist pastors colleagues. I call of all pastors throughout Christianity colleagues. And so I don't know this individual, but he's a pastor. He's a Hispanic pastor. He's a youth pastor of a certain church here in California. Apparently, he has been in jail for 8 months because I guess he was found undocumented. And the wife was on TV yesterday pleading with and asking for a global prayer for this pastor because he has no criminal background. He has been here for quite a while. He's working at a church, has been done powerful ministry, youth ministry throughout the area where the church is and throughout all of Southern California. No criminal background, has a great family, wife and a few kids, yet he has been locked up in prison for 8 months. Church, my heart hurts. It bothers me. Now, I know we have two sides to that story, but the mere fact, it bothers me. Can something be done for this brother who does not have a criminal background, for this brother that is doing the work of the Lord, doing positive things, making changes in society to get him out of prison and get whatever paperwork needs to happen so that he can be here in society, be with his family here in the state of California? Can something happen? Why don't we stand up for those kind of things? This is what I'm talking about. How do we fight, though? Because now when you look at it, you see that things in some ways, just a little bit, are kind of quieting down. There wasn't as many protests this week. There weren't as many. Now the conversation is going more back to COVID-19 and the spikes that are happening. For the last 2 or 3 weeks, it's been about protests. It's been about the funerals, all those various things, about defunding the police, police brutality, racism, and all that. Now, if you look at the media, the news is beginning to change the narrative, the conversation. Now everything's heading back more. It's COVID-19 is being highlighted more once again, and not these protests. And so, what is happening? Are things getting quiet? Are things changing? I don't know. I don't know. But because, and the reason why I don't know. And the reason why I say it is because for me, we're still fighting. For me and my house, we're going to do thus saith the Lord. We are still fighting. And then I've been fighting this battle for over 10, 15 years. And so here is how you fight when things are quiet. Here is the way you continue to fight despite of what's going on. And so I got five lessons for you today. Five lessons for you today quickly. I got five lessons for you today quickly. And here's the order. It spells out the acronym of CHEFS. CHEFS. No pun intended here. Nothing indicative to the sermon, but it just spells out CHEFS. Here's how you fight. We can put this in the chat. Number one, how do you fight when things are quiet? How do you fight even when things are in an uproar? When things are going, when people are protesting, how do you fight? How do you fight when no one is protesting? Well, there are just five common rules or five fundamental things that you have to do to stay engaged, to stay in the fight, because this is not political, but this is biblical. We are in our season, we are in our freedom series. And so how do you fight? Well, the first thing you have to do is you have to stay in church. You have to stay in church. We have to note and understand that church, that Jesus is the author of the church, that Jesus is the foundation of this of the church. On this rock, I will put my church, not Peter, but Jesus, the foundation. He is the rock. He is the chief cornerstone that the builders rejected. Understand that church in the days of Israel, and even for many years and centuries after that, the church was the middle of the community. You had all things that were going all on around, but church was the center of the community. We have to make sure that church is the center of the community because Jesus is the author of the church, and we have to get back to the heart of worship. And we know that it's all about Jesus. Jesus is the middle. Jesus is the pulse. Jesus is the chief cornerstone. Jesus is everything. He's the solution to every problem. The answer to every question is none other than Jesus. And so we got to get back to church. We have to stay in church. Do not forsake the assembly. Church is the pivotal component throughout what we've been looking at. And even when you study civil rights movement, every movement that you study, there was always a church that was behind, spiritual leaders that were behind every movement, whether it was good or bad. They were behind every movement. The reason why I say it was bad, because the Christian church does have a bad name. Because when you talk, that's why I don't use the word crusades. We talk about, we use the word revival. Or we use the words such as the main word, or evangelistic campaigns. But I don't use the words crusades, because crusades have a negative connotation. For it was the crusaders, if you will, that came in and they began to kill people under the banner of Jesus, under the banner of Christianity. And so when you say, I'm going to run an evangelistic crusade, that has a negative connotation because of the crusaders that went in and took people's land and killed people under the name of Christianity. And it was wrong. And so, but we see that spirituality has led many movements. The civil rights movements were led by spiritual leaders such as Martin Luther King and others. It was led by spiritual leader Mahatma Gandhi. Even though he may not have been of the same faith as we believe, he did believe in a man named Jesus. Maybe not in the sense of the Savior, of Jesus the Christ as the Son of God and Son of Man, but he had the same type of thought processes and attitude that Jesus had, the Son of God and the Son of Man. And so we know that spiritual leadership, the church, is behind every movement. When we look at the various things that are happening today, we know that there are spiritual leaders that are behind the movement. All the funerals, obviously we see it happening in churches. We see spiritual leaders that are standing up and talking about these things. We need to stay in church. Note that the church is the critical component of a movement that we need to have in every city, in every county, in every country in the world. It has to be led by the church. Now watch this. Now, when you get to this point, I'm preaching. It's rare that I only preach to the Seventh Adventist Church. All of my sermons, that is always a sermon that will touch the masses and speak to the masses. And sometimes I just come down directly to the Seventh Adventist Church. I preached a sermon a couple weeks ago that was directly to the Seventh Day Adventist Church called It's in the Name. And then that was my only sermon ever that I've done that was specifically to the Seventh Day Adventist Church. This sermon today is not specifically to the Seventh Day Adventist Church. It's for everyone. But at the same time, I have to ensure that the Seventh Day Adventist Church understands what I'm trying to say, because I have been in conversations for years, and I would on points like this, I may have stayed silent with my word, but I would do things with action, because I've always believed in it. Now watch this. I know what I just said could come back to haunt me, if you will, because I just stated that every movement in the world has been led by the church. And so we know our eschatology, our understanding of last day events, that the church is going to lead out in this movement of religious freedom being taken away. I know that. So if you remember what I said specifically, I said that all movements, whether good or bad, have been led by the church. When the church begins to connect with world leaders and they begin to say that we need to remove religious freedom from the Constitution, from the books, and create laws that will negate people from worshiping the way they want to worship, that is a wrong movement. But if I want to stand up for racial discrimination, that's nothing wrong with that. If I want to stand up for the oppressed people, there's nothing wrong with that. If I want to break down systematic racism, there's nothing wrong with that. But that is not political. It is biblical. And the Lord did it all throughout his time here on earth. And he also told those that were in the Old Testament to ensure that they take care of the widows, the orphans, and all, and on and on and on. And so we come down to this understanding that we have to stay in the church We have to stay with the church. How do you fight? You fight by staying in the church, by lifting up Jesus, because I don't care how many times we protest, we got to protest with a purpose. And at the end of it all, we have to know that it's all about Jesus. Every law that we pass, it has to exemplify the kingdom of God. Everything that we do, we must lift up God's kingdom. It is all about Jesus, and Jesus is the foundation and the author of the church. So I stay in the church because I lift up Jesus, the one that died for my sins. I lift up Jesus, the Son, the beginning and the end, the Son of God and the Son of Man. I lift up Jesus. And so we must stay in the church. Number two, we got to stay healthy. How do we fight? We fight by staying in the church. We stay in the church by staying on our knees. How do we fight? We fight by staying healthy. We fight by staying healthy. And the health that I'm talking about and the health kick that I've been on is not all only about physical health, not only about what you eat and how many times you exercise. But I think all those equate to what we call mental health. The demoniac, as we have talked about earlier, the Lord removed those demons from him. And as he removed those demons from him, the Bible says in Mark chapter 5, the Bible says right about verse 17 to 18, it says right there that he was found, he was sitting and clothed and in his right mind. COVID-19 is causing a lot of depression. Social injustice is causing a lot of anxiety. And it has always, the city of San Bernardino, the county of San Bernardino, they have just passed this law where it stated that, or not a law, I shouldn't say, it's not a law. They have just passed this, racism is a public health crisis. Racism is a public health crisis. The county of San Bernardino, the county supervisors, they passed that racism is a public health crisis. Crisis with this understanding that there's a lot of anxiety that's put there, a lot of depression that has been placed upon a certain class of people for one reason or another. And so we see that we have to stay healthy. If you want to stay in the fight, you got to stay healthy. And it's the health of the mind. What you eat impacts the mind. How much you exercise impacts the mind. That's why the Sabbath is so important. There's certain conversations that I do not want to have on the Sabbath because I know it's going to rile me up. There's certain conversations that I don't want to speak on because I know it's going to cause anxiety or cause me to maybe get a little bit of bother and allow my mind to go places that I don't want to go. There are certain conversations, there's certain things, certain people that you may not need to communicate with on the Sabbath because you need some Sabbath rest. Amen, somebody. And so you have to know that you need to have this mental health. Your mind has to be strong. So be careful with what you eat. Be vigilant of how much you exercise. Also, be aware of the things that you look at on TV because you need your mind to be strong. The mind, as they used to say, is a terrible thing to waste. And so you want to stay in this fight? You got to stay in the church. You want to stay in this fight? Keep your mind healthy. You want to stay in this fight? We got to talk about education. We got to talk about education. And so there are different forms of education, but I want to go straight to it. I want to encourage everybody on this call right now that if you want to get another degree, if you want to go back to college, if you want to start a college degree for the first time, if you've been out of school and you want to get some bachelor's, or if you want to get a master's, go back to school. Education is prime to this fight. Education is critical. My mom has always been a stickler for education, and education pays off. There's a lot of things that go on with it. There's student debt, there's different things, but at the end of the day, no one can take away what you have in your mind. And if you cannot get back to school, just make sure that you spend time in reading, in research. Make sure that you know what you're reading, you understand. Make sure you're able to form opinions. Make sure you're able to articulate. Education is critical. Make sure you know the laws that are being passed. Make sure you read up on the people that you're voting for before you vote for them. Education, education, education. Knowledge is power. And note that we have, in order to fight this battle, How do you fight? You got to stay educated. This is not when they're protesting, you are still being educated. When they stop protesting, you are still educating your mind. This is how to fight when times are at, when times are a little bit more quiet. How do you fight? How do you sustain yourself? How do you stay in the fight? The fundamentals of fighting is staying in the church. The fundamentals of fighting is staying healthy. The fundamentals of fighting is having an education. The fundamentals of fighting, number four, is family. Family. The family structure is a critical component of staying in the fight. One of the reasons why we have so many issues today is because the family structure has been broken up. The enemy knows, and I talked about it last week, Saturday evening. The enemy knows that if he can remove a man from the home, the chances of your children being going into prison or getting in trouble are higher than if the father is in the home. We have to look at the numbers. The enemy knows and understands, and so he has always tried to usurp the power of the man from the home. It is important that we have strong family structures. And if for some reason, brothers, I'm talking to you now, if you have children and you are not in the home with the young lady you had children with, ensure you find a way to stay in their life. Make sure that you call them. Make sure that you pick them up. Make sure that you spend time with them. This is how you fight, because the family structure is so important. We have to ensure that our families, as best as they can, they stay together. We have to do more to ensure that the church families, that families in the church, that they stay together. And if they are not, if we see single mothers coming inside of the church, we have to help her with her children. If we see single fathers coming inside the church, we have to help him with his children. We have to make sure, as Walter said it to us last Wednesday, that it's not about church family. It's just about family. We are one big family, and we have to stay together. The closer we are together, the harder it will be for the enemy to penetrate. A family that prays together, worships together, is a family that stays together. And I want to continue to reiterate the importance of the family structure. When we bring new people into the church, it's cool to bring them in one by one, but I want to begin to baptize family. When you're praying and we have this G Street revival, let's pray to the Lord that he will bring to us family. Let's bring families back into the church. Let this church feel as if that this is a family-oriented place. We have something for everyone. People have left this great church. When I'm talking about this great church, I'm talking about the San Bernardino Community Seventh-day Adventist Church. For a fact, I know people have left because we haven't had everything for the family. We may have something here. We may have something for this person, for this, but we don't have something for the entire family. We have to find a way to ensure, and on all pastors that are listening to me, we got to find a way to ensure that we have something for the total family. We have to keep the family structure intact. This is how you fight. And lastly, you fight with the church. You fight through health. You fight through education. We fight through family, a family, a strong family structure. And lastly, you fight through stewardship. I use that word stewardship because it's a word that we understand. But actually, I really want to say economic empowerment. Yeah, I'm gonna pause right there. You fight by staying in church. You fight by having strong mental health. You fight by having a strong education. You continue to fight by having a strong family structure. And you fight with good stewardship that with the word is economic empowerment. It's not about money. It's not about money. However, money is vital to your progression in society, if you will. how do I say this without making an appeal? Well, I'm just going to say it. One of the reasons why in the beginning, when I first got into pastoring, I didn't talk about money because I never wanted to be labeled as some type of pastor that only talks about money all the time. But you know what? It's okay. And you could take whatever you want from this part of the sermon. That's up to you. But for those that know me, know that I'm telling the truth, because at the end of the day, when your check is short, you're gonna make sure and call your employer, try to find out, why didn't I get all my money inside of my bank account? Oh yeah, when your bank account is running negative, you're gonna try to find a way to ensure that you put some money back into the bank to make it positive. When your bills come up and you are being charged higher than what you thought you should be, higher than what it should be, the electric bill is higher than what it should be, the water bill is higher than it should be, you're getting ready to call those people. So please, watch this. Economic empowerment is so critical to us so that we can fight. We got to ensure that we have good stewardship. When you talk about economic empowerment, it's not about investing in businesses as much as it is investing in the kingdom of God. There's nothing wrong with doing investment in people, or if you want to invest in businesses, if you want to do that's whatever you want to do. But make sure that your treasure is being invested first and foremost in the kingdom of God. And know and understand that the Jesus economy is found in the Old Testament specifically, primarily, but we also see it played out in the New Testament. But when you look at the way that the Hebrews lived, this was the Jesus economy, powerful, or the Hebrew economy, which was found under the banner of God. And when you look at what some will call theoeconomics, you will know and understand how the Israelites were financially powerful, how they were financially well off. They didn't have to depend on anyone else. They may not have had as much money as other people, as other nations, but they were strong. They were financially strong for their nation. We, watch this. First of all, as a family, we have to become financially strong. You, as an individual, must become financially strong. As you become financially strong, then the church will become financially stronger, because when you are financially strong, then you're able to give more and invest more in the church, and the church can be stronger, and the church can do more for God's kingdom. I hope y'all are with me. So good stewardship, your time, yeah, your testimony, yeah, your tithe and offering is important. We have to have economic empowerment. In order for us to do more here at San Bernardino, to do more in Victorville, salvation is free, but ministry costs. It costs money for people to go out there and knock on doors. As much as you want to say, oh, we could do it for free. No. So because not everyone is consistent in doing it. It costs money to create flyers. It costs money to print. It costs money to put up a tent. It costs money to put up a $5 million complex. It costs money to be in the church for the electricity. It costs money. However, we need to become financially strong. We have to become financially strong. So it starts at home. Then it goes from home to the church. And then from the church, it goes into the community. And this is how you fight. Because when you are financially strong, you can have a stronger or a louder voice at the table. It is a sad thing, but people only look at certain people. And so if we're strong, people will look at us. We will have a louder voice at the table. And our voice will be speaking for none other than our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so how do we fight? This is how you fight. And once again, this thing is not about trying to have the biggest house and have the biggest car. You want to be able to take care of yourself, but you also want to leave something to take care of the church. You want to leave something to take care of somebody else. Take care of your family. Take care of your church. Take care of people that you don't know. Because at the end of the day, the Lord will bless you. For this place is not our home. We go back to the beginning of the message, that this place, we are pilgrims, we are sojourners. This place is not our home. So your money does not mean anything in heaven. Your money does not, your big house does not mean anything in God's eyes. Your fancy cars, your fancy suits does not mean anything.
because God is the one who has all the money. When we get to heaven, we're going to walk on streets that are paved with gold. That's how much money God owns. It said he owns a cattle on 1,000 hills. That's how much money he owns. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. And so don't get it twisted that God needs your money. God is testing out your faith in many ways. However, we must become economically powerful, financially solvent, financially secure, financially faithful. We have to become financially strong. We have to be good stewards of what God has given to us. And this is how we fight. We fight through the church. This is how we fight. We fight through health. This is how we fight. We fight through education. This is how we fight. We fight through with strong family structure. This is how we fight. We fight through good stewardship. Lastly, as I get ready to close, Let me close with this story. And then come looking at my time. I'm already past my time. Let me close with this story. Here's a familiar passage of scripture that you know well that I think will tie it all in. How do we fight? This is how we fight. There was a man by the name of Stephen, found in the book of Acts, chapter 6 and 7 and 8. This man by the name of Stephen, he was a deacon. When you understand how the deacons came about, it had to do with some social injustices. That's how the deacons came about. Go back and study the scriptures. They were being, the word got back to the disciples that there were a certain group of people not being well taken care of. Those group of people were widows. The Hellenists were upset that their widows were not being taken care of. So God has already instructed us to take care of the orphans, to take care of orphans, fatherless, to take care of the widow. And so we see the way the deacon assignment, the role of a deacon came out came out because there were some social injustices. And the disciples came in, the apostle said, you know what? We have to continue to spread the gospel. So I'm going to leave 7 men in this area to oversee the church, to oversee the problem that they're having, that our widows are not being taken care of. And so one of those men were Stephen. Ah, stay with me now. So we see it. Now we see that man Stephen that was a man of good reputation, filled with the Holy Spirit. How do you fight? This is how you fight. Stephen was doing what he was supposed to do every single day, ensuring that the widows were taken care of, ensuring that the church was being well taken care of. But yet still, you have people that were hating on Stephen. They always tried to debate Stephen. They always tried to find fault with Stephen. They were kept on calling out Stephen, but Stephen kept on staying faithful to God's word. He kept on being faithful to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, to one day it got him caught up to the Sanhedrin. And as he was taken to the Sanhedrin, the religious leaders of that day, they began to ask him questions. Why do you keep on talking about? And why do you keep on living for this man that you call Jesus, the Son of God, the one that proclaimed to be the Son of God? Why do you keep on talking about him? Why do you keep on living for him? Why do you keep on doing these things? And so Stephen began to have a long conversation with him. He took him from Abraham to Moses, down to David, and he took him all the way to the death of Jesus, to the resurrection of Jesus, telling them that it was their fault. That it was them that crucified Jesus. And it was the conversation that he had. It made them so upset. It made them so angry. You know the story, that they took Stephen out and they began to stone Stephen. And as they began to stone Stephen, Stephen remembered what Jesus had said on the cross. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Stephen remembered those words. As we are in this fight, and people are stoning us, as we are in this fight, because we have now come out of, we are fighting, and we are in this, we've come out, we've started, our purpose is part of social injustices that are in the world. Just like Stephen, a man of good reputation, filled with the Holy Spirit, so are we, men and women, filled with the Holy Spirit, men and women of good reputation. Now we are fighting, and as we are fighting, stones are being thrown at us. They are throwing stones at us in every which way. But we can't be mad. We gotta fight, and we gotta fight in peace. We gotta ensure that we have peaceful protests. We gotta fight with education. We gotta fight with the family structure. We gotta fight by being strong mentally. We gotta fight by staying engaged in the church. We gotta fight with having good stewardship. And as they are throwing stones at us, we keep on fighting. We keep on asking God to forgive them. We keep on desiring for God to save their soul. Because remember, at the end of Stephen's life, he didn't die without seeing Jesus. Amen, somebody. The Bible says that Stephen looked up, and as Stephen looked up, he saw Jesus not sitting. It would have discouraged me if the Bible would have said that Jesus was sitting on the right side of God. The Bible says that Jesus was standing on the right side of his Father, looking down, peering over. Stephen saw that, and it showed, and when he passed away, when he died, there was like a light around his face. When he died, it was like there was a smile on his face, because he knew that his labor, his death was not in vain. And he looked up and he saw Jesus standing on the right side of his Father, letting him know that I got you, son. I got your back. You did what I've asked you to do. Now you will die, but you will be sleeping in peace. But when I come again, I'm going to raise you up. Church family, let me tell you that we got to live prophetically and we got to preach prophetically, that we have to do thus saith the Lord. We got to stand up for freedom for people. We got to stand up for what is right. We got to take care of those that God has asked us to take care of. We have to ensure that those that are weak, that us as a strong people, that we ensure that we take care of those that are weak. We have to stand up for what is right. We have to exemplify Jesus. We got to do what God has said. This is prophetic living, but we also have to preach prophetically and let them know that they cannot take away our religious freedom, that we got to keep on being able to worship on the Sabbath day, on the seven-day Sabbath. We got to stand up for what is right. And as we stand up, you best believe that Jesus is standing with us. We are not standing alone. Jesus is with us every single step of the way. So let them throw rocks at us. Let them talk about us all they want. But I know that Jesus is standing with me. And as long as Jesus is standing with me, I can stand as well. For he lives. I can face tomorrow because my God lives. All fear is gone. We got to stand up for Jesus as he stands up for us. And as he stands up for us, we will know without a shadow of a doubt that when he comes, if we die in this battle, our labor will not be in vain in the Lord. If we die in this battle, let's believe that Jesus will come and he will raise us up in that first resurrection, and we will walk on streets paved with gold. We will eat from the tree of life. We will sit and talk with Jesus forever and ever and ever. So this is how you fight. You fight by standing up. But thus saith the Lord, because Jesus is standing up for you. Oh, Lord, I thank you for this time that we share together. The hour is late, oh, God, and I just thank you for the patience of your people. I pray, oh, God, that this will encourage us even more as we are in the second part of our freedom series. Lord, that we will note that we have to be people that will stand up for you, because you have and you are standing up for us. Let us be people of education, people of good stewards, people of that desire to keep a family structure together, people that believe in strong mental health and health in general, people that want to stay engaged in church. Help us to be those type of people, Father, so that, Lord, that we can stay in the fight, or so that we will know how to fight. I don't know what the future holds, oh God, but I do know who holds the future. So God, do, Lord, for us what only you can do. We thank you for this time that we share together. Now, Lord, we ask you that, Lord, that you will bless us, Father, this evening, that we will come back all together as a church family, sharing this space with another church, Lord, showing unity, Father, showing a sense of solidarity, standing up, Father, for the voiceless, stand up for those that are weak, oh God. Lord, I just pray for a great evening together, that the church will show up for a moment like this, oh God, and that, Father, Lord, that we will continue to glorify and lift up the kingdom of God. Now unto him who is able to keep us from falling, and to present us faultless before the only wise God, with exceeding joy, dominion, majesty, and power, both now and forever. Let the church say amen, amen, and amen. Again, your offering
You could send in your offering, San Bernardino Community SDA Church, P.O. Box 10125, San Bernardino, California, 92423. If you're in the Victorville Area Restoration Center, P.O. Box 755, Victorville, California, 92393. Or you could just go online, and you can also give your tithe and offering that way. If you're going to be here at the church this evening, you can also return your tithe and offering here at the San Bernardino Community Seventh-day Adventist Church. Remember tonight, 7 o'clock, for all those that will be helping, please, please, please show up at 5 o'clock. All those that will be helping, we thank Elder Wesley Thompson, my dad, for the great Sabbath school lesson. I love it that it's not about us mastering the scriptures, but about the scriptures mastering us. We thank Sister Nancy Irby for the great messages and song. We thank you for all the participation, for the time of prayer. Elder Shane, thank you. Yes, we thank you for the word that teaches us how to continue to fight. We got to get that education. Don't be afraid to go back into the university. Conciana, we're lifting you up in prayer. We are a church that believes in education. And if you can't, for one reason or another, make sure you stay educated in the word. Make sure you stay educated just by reading, having knowledge. Knowledge is power. Be financially financially faithful. Be faithful in your stewardship and your tithe and offering. Economic empowerment is so important. Let's keep the family structure together. We got to keep families together. We got to do more for our families. We got to have more for the families here at this church. We got to stay mentally strong. So exercise, eat right, you know, and find things to that will keep your mind stress-free. And then lastly, let's stay in church. Do not forsake the assemblies. When we open up that tent in the next couple of weeks, I want everybody to show up. All those that can, that are part of this community, as part of this faith, show up. If you're part of other communities and you just want to join us, come on and join us until your church opens up. It's going to be a fabulous time. May God bless each one of you. I'll see you tonight at 7 o'clock. For those that are helping, I'll see you at 5 o'clock. This is how you fight. Stand up for Jesus, for he will stand up for you. Amen and amen again. For all those that want to stay on the line,